start, can I welcome everybody to this meeting of the Cabinet. Thank you for your attendance. Can I start off by giving apologies of Councillor Phil Brownmore, not able to be with us this morning. If they could be recorded, I'd be grateful. Okay, let's go straight into the agenda. Item one is Members' Code of Conduct. Do any Cabinet members wish to declare any interest? Angie?
Yes, if I can, I'd like to declare a personal interest in item number three. I've got a family member who is in receipt of assisted travel, and also in item number six, I'm a CWP employee, and CWP is mentioned in the report.
Okay, so they're personal interest.
It's the same personal interest in number six, because I'm an employee of CWP.
Okay, anybody else? No? Okay, so we'll call those of interest. Item two of minutes of the last meeting. Can we agree that our sign was a true record?
Agreed.
So we have a number of executive key decisions taken under delegated powers. Just to approve those decisions? Yeah, can we approve that?
Agreed.
Agreed. Thank you. Okay, so item number four is the draft calendar of meetings for the 2018-2019 municipal year. You can see the calendar before you. The recommendations are on page 20, and there's still an opportunity, as you can see from the recommendations, for any proposed amendments to be submitted to the Assistant Director of Law and Governance by no later than 10 a.m. on Friday, 9th of March. But there's one amendment that I want to just notify you of today. So I've been informed that Children and Families Scrutiny Committee will move from the 6th of June to the 3rd of July at the request of the Scrutiny Team. So can we agree that change? Is that agreed? Yes.
Agreed.
And as I say, there's an opportunity for further amendments to be made by that date. So I'm going to ask you to, Cabinet, to agree the recommendations on page 20. Are they agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. Okay, which takes us to item number five, which is the Wirral Waters One Legacy Project, Dock Road, Wallasey, Wirral. I just want to say a few words about this project. I mean, this is a really important project for not just Wirral Waters, but for the whole kind of the regeneration work that we're doing across Wirral generally. This will be the first residential development on Wirral Waters, the new residential development. And I'm really excited about this. I think it'll be the catalyst for a number of other residential projects in the wake of getting this over the line. As you can see from the report, it's quite a complicated legal arrangement and a deal, but I think in essence to have 500 units, 20% affordable on a brownfield site is a real good news story, because it starts to create that community, if you like, in that part of Wirral Waters which we want to bring more residents down to. And also it relieves pressure on the Greenbelt, because we're building on brownfield land, which we've always said is our number one priority. So I think for all of those reasons, this is a really exciting project, and one that I'm very keen to see happen. And it looks as though we're moving quite close now to get all the I's dotted and the T's crossed. We're being asked to agree today in principle to participating in the scheme, but clearly there are a number of outstanding issues still to be finalised, and the set of recommendations on page 40 is suggesting or was requesting a further report to cabinet, and hopefully we'll have everything bottomed out. But I think the main thing today to say is, you know, this is a really good a good news story. It's the kind of thing that I think will kickstart a lot of development on rural waters. We know that we've got projects that Urban Splash want to do, residential projects, develop an extra care dementia facility, and then we've got some of the more employment-related uses, so we've got Maritime Knowledge Hub on the Tower Road, we've got the Skills Factory at the other end of the site. So a lot of really exciting activity, I think, on rural waters over the next 12 to 18 months, which this will be the start of. And then if you link that together with some of the announcements we'll be making on Wednesday around the growth company, I think it's great news for Wirral, and it's about bringing, you know, new jobs and investment into the borough, which is absolutely in line with what we promised to do with our 20 pledges, and this hits a number of those pledges. So I think for all those reasons, it's something we should support and embrace, and I look forward to the further report when all the details will hopefully have been resolved. So that's really all I want to say. George, Cabinet for Housing, do you want to say anything on this one?
Just to say, Phil, support everything you just said. I think it's the catalyst that will set off with the waters. Been waiting a long time for it to come. I'm very, very pleased to see that the 500 new homes, of which 20% of those will be affordable. So I'm very pleased to support your comments that you just made. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm just going to move to the recommendations on page 40. Just notify Colin of a minor typo on clause C. Of the recommendations 2C, it should say 50 year lease, so the word year needs to be added. Just to show I've read the report. So can we agree those recommendations?
Please.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, that takes us then to item number 6, which is the integrated commissioning progress update. And Chris, you're going to take us through this, please.
Thank you, Phil. This report provides Cabinet with an update on the progress of the NHS and social care integration programmes, which are underway at the moment, and they're in development. And in response to the scrutiny request, the publication of a due diligence report, which is on page 47 of your agenda, focusing on potential risks of outputting of resources. I'm sure I've said very often in here that the Council is working with our colleagues in the NHS to create a more joined up, a stronger and far more efficient health and social care service. As we know, the Council's social care service for older people is already fully integrated with the NHS Community Trust and is working really successfully for the benefit of patients and the staff, who now appreciate the roles that each other have and the difference in health and social care. The Council, as we know, is also developing a proposal to integrate our mental health and disability services with Cheshire Mental Partnership, and to again provide people with a better and far more seamless service than they're getting at the moment. The other big integration programme we're working on at the moment is Wirral Council, including Public Health, and Wirral NHS CCG, pooling its resources to create an integrated commissioner for Wirral for shared governance to ensure NHS and care services and wellbeing resources go further, and to enable us to actually strengthen our local NHS and social care services. The integration programmes are designed to support many of our pledges, all my people pledges, in particular older people live well, residents live healthy lives, and people with disabilities live independently. The reasons for the recommendations that I'm giving is that we know as demand for services for health and social care are absolutely growing. This is an imperative part of our plan, really, to try and find new ways to meet residents' needs. And the recommendations, which are on page 50, following the request from the scrutiny committee, if you look at 3.7, and it states there that the Adult Care and Health Scrutiny Committee made this recommendation. It is recommended to Cabinet that this report should be released, but that the sensitive nature of this content should be redacted. We've got the arrangement where we need to make a Section 75 agreement for the pooling of funds. So the year one arrangements at the moment will include the running of the large part of potentially pooled funding in a shadow form, so that we're not at risk of, we can absolutely keep an eye really on what we're doing. And the Cabinet is recommended to instruct officers to release the report, but if we could do it during the summer, subject to the public interest concerns easing as appropriate mitigations are developed, agreed and put in place. So the recommendations 1 to 4 are on page 50, which I'd like to ask Cabinet to agree.
Okay, thanks Chris. Just to reiterate, this is about better integration between health and social care. That's the reason why we're doing this. And it is absolutely the case that we are still four square behind the principle of a publicly funded NHS free at the point of use. I think that is that principle needs to be restated. We're not moving away from that principle, but we are both sectors, both health and social care, facing huge financial challenges and constraints, and we need to use the rural pound more wisely. And I think, from my point of view, it's entirely in line with that principle that we're doing this for. We've already done one, I think, quite successful integration with our adult social workers going to the NHS Community Trust, and I think that's going to be the direction of travel. Otherwise, we're going to be both their health and social care will be struggling to deliver those vital frontline services given government cuts to both sets of budgets. So this does make sort of eminent sense. And I think the recommendation around releasing the report after we've done the due diligence around the Section 75 agreement makes sense. So I think for all of those reasons, I would concur with Chris's recommendations. They're set out on page 50 of the Cabinet report. So can we agree those recommendations, Cabinet?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. Right, which takes us then to item 7, which are the admission arrangements for community and voluntary control primary and secondary schools and the coordinated admission schemes for 2019 and 2020. Snap very snappy title. Bernie, you'll take us through this, please.
Thank you, Phil. This is the policy that determines the school's admission arrangements for the rural office. It's a policy that comes each year, so I'm not going to labour the point. There's a copy of the policy, there's a list of all the schools and the number of children to be admitted, so there's no changes to the policy for last year. So all I'm going to do is just ask the Cabinet to agree the recommendations on page 55. It's no use labelling it because it's something that we do each year, so thank you.
Yeah, okay, so standard report this time of year for admission arrangements for our schools, as Bernie said. So you've got the document in front of you and we're being asked to agree those arrangements. Can we agree that recommendation? Thank you very much. So that takes us on then to item 8, Regional Adoption Agency. Bertie, could you again, please?
Thank you. Okay, following the introduction of the Education and Adoption Act in 2016, which sets out the aims for a regional, to regionalise the adoption agency and to provide a better way of finding stable and loving homes as quickly as possible for our children. This is a statutory obligation for all authorities. We have now set up our partnership with Liverpool, Wallasey, Sefton and Wirral. And it's to find a way forward for us. So we're now called, we come under what's called AIM, A-I-M, which is the Adoption and Merseyside Partnership. a lead, Wallasey is going to be the lead or the host authority, and Sefton is going to take responsibility for the commissioning on behalf of the other four authorities. Our staff are going to be transferred over. They will be based still as they are in Wirral, but they'll be transferred over. As I say, it's a statutory obligation that we have to go forward, and it's quite an exciting development for our adopted children. So the recommendations for all of this is on page 93. So if everybody's happy with it, it's just an extension of, I think we've had a couple of reports from the cabinet about this, so it's just the sort of the next step to finalise where we are. So if everybody's happy with that, recommendations are on page 93.
Okay, thanks. Mark, as you say, it's that's a requirement now that we adopt a regional model for this service, and you can see the detail, and it goes live on the 1st of April. So we wish it well, and look forward to kind of reports on how it develops. So can we agree those recommendations as we find them?
Thank
you very much. Okay, that brings us to the end of the public business. We've got one item of exempt information, so I have to ask the Cabinet, can we agree to the exemption? The item is contains commercial confidential information, so can I move the exclusion of the press and public? Is that seconded? Can I agree? So can I ask the press and public to please leave the meeting? Thank you for your attendance.